Okay, welcome to the Center for Internet and Society. Unfortunately, we don't have the time to get into what we do. Welcome to the Center for Internet and Society.
Thank you.
This is Apar Gupta, the chief guest for the day. You might know Apar from his work as Executive Director of the Internet Freedom Foundation. Of course, he's been working in this field for about 20 years now.
50.
Where was the IT commentary?
IT commentary was in 2006 in law school.
Yes. And just a second. Since then, he's been involved in several important legal challenges as well. The Shreya Singhal case in 2015 that challenged 66A of the IT Act, 69A of the IT Act, and some parts of 79 of the IT Act. And then he was involved in the right to privacy petition, Puttaswamy versus Union of India, and then subsequently the Aadhaar case as we know it. And now IFF is working in digital freedoms very broadly. Today he'll be talking about internet shutdowns and the legal framework around it, and especially the Supreme Court's judgment in Anuradha Bhasin versus Union of India that came earlier this year. But IFF, of course, works in automated facial recognition, the use of it by the police, and privacy security online, just generally.
Yeah, so, and there's some keychains here. Everyone needs a keychain, I've been told by my staff. We need cards, but we need keychains. And there's encryption is key written there, they came up with it. It's kind of cute. So please do pick it up. We as an organization are primarily funded by individuals who become our members. So this is a snapshot of our plans. This is not a tie-in, if you may think so, but it is also a tie-in. Okay. And when I say it's completely voluntary, I mean it. Okay. So take more than one, if you would like. Pay us more than once, if you would like. Okay, and I'll get started on this small talk. The way I'm thinking of dividing it is that we can possibly have a conversation around this. So it's not great if I just keep speaking, and I intend to shut up at around 6:40 after half an hour. Around. Okay.
Cool. Then we'll have an open discussion.
Yeah, we can have an open discussion. So we can first start on internet shutdowns. And you may be curious about the wider work which IFF does. So you can basically question me, interrogate me, cross-examine me, ask me to do better, or just say that, hey, you guys are fantastic. So yeah, we like that as well.
Just one request apart.
What?
You like to walk around while you speak, but this is broadly the area you will be visible in the live stream.
Okay, so how do I do this?
This side, that's right. We can move that chair if you want.
So, I think
just
we,
some.
Even then, I'm not visible, even if when I'm stepping here. So, we
sure.
Mean, it's just.
We'll.
This might be better.
Yeah.
That's okay. I think the slides and your voice will be.
Do you want to tether to my iPhone?
No. I'll just. You mean tether that?
No, this one.
Yeah,
it's
fine.
Disconnect to the one. Just
okay.
A little bit of housekeeping before we begin. This is the CIS office. This is the code of conduct for the event. If you don't have an opportunity to read it, just basically don't be a jerk.
And
the prevention of sexual harassment policy also applies. It's broadly equivalent to the law, but it is gender agnostic. If you have any complaints, you can tell me or
to
Dorsha right there, raise your hand. Especially if you have a complaint against me, then you should obviously tell her. And okay, Apar, thanks.
Thank you so much. It's downloading a driver for the projector. Just switch that off.
Yeah, the iTunes, right?
It's, is it iTunes? No, no, no. No, it's not iTunes. It's listening to something else. I agree. Deny this?
I think you can. Okay. Yeah, it should be fine.
And now I don't know why iTunes popped up.
Yeah, we just close this.
Yeah. No, no, don't.
Yeah. No, that thing we can close.
This one?
Yeah. And now we can present. We can present all of it.
We have not started selling them yet, like EFF guys. So I know they are not cool, but we'll get there. Okay, I know what to do.
Yeah.
Okay. So monitors display. Can you plug out and plug in again?
Yeah.
No plug in. Okay. Can I email this to you? I've shared it already. If you have a laptop which already works with this.
What's up?
I think it has a dual display setup.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Does that work?
Oh, it's in different words. Okay. Let me just close everything.
If you're clicking present, it's not showing up.
Yeah, it's a big problem.
Any Mac users?
I think it should show the dual display.
No.
Can we just mirror the screen perhaps?
Yeah, no, it's.
Does that too?
Yeah. We need to delete desktop too.
Yeah, that
should
be done. Tell me that's done. Yeah.
View.
Actually, just go to desktop one now, and maybe desktop two should just appear there. Okay. Yeah. Let's just remove one workspace. Okay.
I think
the and view. It's showing Firefox already there.
Mm-hmm. You're using some kind of a driver.
No, maybe it's Pegasus. I don't know.
Yeah. One second. Can you just try to mirror the screen? Yeah. This is it, right?
Yeah. It doesn't show those preferences. That's the issue. I'll just email it out to any laptop you have already set up here. I've shared it to both of your CISS account. So you already have rights to it.
I can get mine. Yeah.
Okay. Anyways, before we get started here, most of you come from the tech policy sector, right? Do you have any?
This was a public talk.
But yeah.
Selection.
Yeah, but usually people will be, just to assess the crowd, how many people know about internet shutdowns already? Everyone, right? Okay. I'll make it very technical. Very nice.
May I just share it with particular email address?
It's shared with you already.
That's not a Google enabled account, so I'll have to.
We listen to better stuff. Poor people who are online. It works.
Okay, go.
Okay.
Maybe I can.
So this is a version of a talk that I have built out over two other presentations that I've done, but I've also inserted certain aspects which have emerged post the Anuradha Bhasin judgment, which was on January 10th, 2020. So just to take you through, and I can toggle the slides, I'll move here, it'll work better. So, can you hear me now? Is the couch comfortable? Okay. So, on August 5th, the internet was shut down in Jammu and Kashmir, and this was after the state was converted to a union territory and Article 370 was scrapped. And internet shutdowns had been occurring in Kashmir since at least 2013, which also got internet access way later than other parts of India. But internet shutdowns, what we have seen, is no longer restricted to Kashmir and is happening all over India, in parts of Uttar Pradesh, in Bihar, in Rajasthan, in Delhi, in Maharashtra, in Tamil Nadu. I think it's also happened in West Bengal, Darjeeling, and I think there was also an instance in Odisha. So by itself, it is a Kashmir to Kanyakumari problem. Okay, it's no longer about the about Kashmir as a isolated instance of exceptionalism, which is an argument quite often which is made that this is a measure only for Kashmir. And this also goes back to the legal regulation which permits this kind of connectivity to be completely snapped all across India. It comes from the Indian Telegraph Act and the rules made under that, which are the telecom suspension rules. So the Indian Telegraph Act is in fact a very curious development. If somebody reads Vikram Raghavan's book on communications law in India, he in fact attributes it partially to how after the what the Britishers called
is the mutiny in which sepoys rebelled to what is called by much more nationalistic writers as the first war of Indian independence. The telegraph became a central feature alongside the railways to extend dominion and political control by the British over all physical boundaries of India. And the manifestation of that control will not only be the telegraph itself, it will also be the legal regulation which underlines it. Hence, the Indian Telegraph Act in 1872 presents a very colonial blueprint where the power vests in a sovereign, and the sovereign is actually Queen Victoria or one of the other great people who have ruled over this country. And that structure and that entitlement of power does go over a tremendous change with the adoption of the constitution, several precedents on telecommunications law. But it brings me back to Vikram, which how he quotes the cry of a mutineer who is about to be hung in one of the barracks after they are caught. And that mutineer basically points to the telegraph signal, which is carrying the death warrant, and says that this accursed string strangles us all. He's about to be hung quite soon. And he's hung. So, just going forward with how the Telegraph Act continues to strangle free communications in India, let's now focus on the Anuradha Bhasin judgment. The Anuradha Bhasin judgment is a limited challenge. It is a challenge only to the actual orders which have been passed by the Jammu and Kashmir administration to shut down telecommunication services by itself. It is not a challenge to the actual existence of the power, which is drawing from Section 5, Subsection 2 of the Indian Telegraph Act. If you look at Section 5, Subsection 2, it in fact has two powers. And I will not get into the second power today, which is used much more predominantly and predates internet shutdowns, which is that power, trivia quiz, for teaching, which is the power used most predominantly under Section 5, Subsection 2 of the Telegraph Act? No. Interception. Yeah. And yeah, interception. Yes, to intercept a message or a class of messages. And the rules made under that are made after the Supreme Court again gives a direction in the PUCL judgment in 1996, right, which is Rule 419. Now, let's not get into that. Let's go back to what is the nature of the talk today, which is telecommunication shutdowns. Now, with regard to telecommunication shutdowns, battery saving. Oops. Okay, we're back. Excellent.
Right.
So the Anuradha Bhasin case only challenges the exercise of the power, which means the legal order which has been passed under the Telegraph Act to shut down internet services. And the curious thing when the petition is filed is that it does not annex any one of the orders which actually led to the internet being shut down in Kashmir. Now, why is that? Careless lawyering? Somebody wanting to go to court really, really quickly and not being able to prepare, or something much more sinister? It is something sinister. The government does not want to show these orders and does not want to show these orders even to the court, and initially claims the ground of privilege. Imagine claiming privilege by which an order shuts down telecommunications in an entire state and not furnishing it. Not only to the public, but even to the court. And eventually the court does require the government to furnish orders, but what is furnished by the government are only 10 sample orders before the Supreme Court, in which what is the official excuse cited by the government not to furnish them? It is no longer privilege on national security, because they have already said they are not claiming that. Administrative difficulties. So, yeah. But this is something which does come out of the Anuradha Bhasin case. The court quite clearly seems perturbed that the government not only has shut down the internet, but is not also providing a copy of the order by which it is reasoning why
how, when, and in which area it is shutting down the internet. By itself, omitting to state the reasons and rationality which would link those reasons to the reasonable restrictions permissible for it to exercise that power. So, in a lot of ways, we walked into the court a bit blind, and our first threshold battle, in fact, was to make the government actually disclose the internet shutdown orders, the reasons and when they were passed to the petitioners by itself. If the Internet Freedom Foundation provided counsel to two journalist bodies besides Anuradha Bhasin, which are the Foundation for Media Professionals and the Indian Journalists Union, and Anuradha Bhasin, who is the petitioner, is the editor of Kashmir and publisher of Kashmir Times. So she approaches the court as a journalist and argues that the internet shutdown in Kashmir is illegal and contests the orders which are not before the court. The orders are furnished before the court. And then we get into what is the context of these orders and what does the court do. But does the court do anything or does it not do anything at all? You've read possibly a few op-eds around it. What is your general sense? What did the court hold? What did the court say? Anyone here? Yeah.
The main critique has been that it does give us some progressive precedent, but it fails to apply it in the case of the present case itself. So
yeah.
It directs the government to make such orders available.
Yeah.
In this case and in subsequent cases. But, and it reforms the review committee that every 7 days the internet shutdown order has to be reviewed by that.
Yeah. And that's a very good way to crystallize what happens. So these are all the good parts of the judgment, which I like to call the meh. Okay. So transparency. All orders will now be published. Okay. But the previous orders under which the telecom shutdown was actually done, there's no comment. There's no publication. There's no disclosure. And we still do not know why and how the internet was shut down for close to 5 months predating this judgment in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. The second thing is that it applies the doctrine of proportionality, and it states that an indefinite internet shutdown is illegal and cannot be done in any case. And thirdly, it directs a review of the rules which provide a sort of a standard operating practice, which are the telecom suspension rules made under Section 5(2) of the Telegraph Act. To break it down, the Constitution permits the state to restrict freedom of speech and expression under reasonable restrictions. These reasonable restrictions need to substantively emerge from Article 19(2), but they also should be reasonable and they should be abridged by a law. A law will usually be a formal enactment, such as the Indian Telegraph Act. And the procedure for that will be set by delegated legislation, such as the internet suspension rules. Quite often, people say that the rules and the process by itself provide a sense of actual standards, which can be then used by people for remedies. So the court actually asks for a review of the rules and says that any internet shutdown order after every week will have to be reviewed by a review committee. A review committee composes of senior bureaucrats of the government, and it basically makes findings and sends its findings to the state government, and the state government can consider it. The review committee does not have the formal power of revoking the internet shutdown order. It can only make findings and send it back to the government. And the government can basically sit on it. The government passes the order, the government receives it and can revoke the order. But what we have seen post the Anuradha Bhasin judgment has been very peculiar. And this is what I also want to come to, and how it may have certain indications where future research can be directed. So what's bad in the judgment? it shifts back not only a review of the rules, but a review of the actual orders to the state government. So it actually formally recognizes the state government to have an immense power, as much as it says a lot about proportionality, that you can't have a perpetual internet shutdown, and it says that the government by itself should review the, firstly, the actual internet shutdown orders in Kashmir, and secondly, it also asks for the entire rules which don't have these kind of safeguards of the internet shutdown orders being reviewed. It also asks the entire administrative setup to be completely overhauled. Have we seen any positive movement on it? No, we have not till now. The second is, the status quo remains in a lot of ways, because the court does not even adjudicate on the 9 sample orders, which after a lot of argument and a lot of attempt was finally furnished before the Supreme Court of India. So the Supreme Court basically says these 9 sample orders which are furnished to us may be right, may be wrong, we are not getting into it. So it avoids its core duty of judicial determination, what Chintan Chandrachud calls as an act of abdication in the op-ed in the Indian Express. And the third is, the court seems to get into some amount of technicality around what can be done when internet shutdowns have been imposed. It says that you can look towards permitting some range of websites which are essential when the internet shutdowns are there. So you can do some kind of selective filtering. And what we have seen come through this judgment have been 5 clear things. I won't get into what are opportunities, because I'll come to that a little later. So the first thing that it does is that the first review and the fresh order it issues after the Anuradha Bhasin judgment is that it permits byline access for internet. Now, if you read the latest telecommunications quarterly indicators report from the Telecom Regulatory Authority in India, wireline access only constitutes about at most 3% of how people access the internet in India. Okay, so it does not result in any meaningful remedy, and also the wireline access which is permitted after the January 10th order by the January 10th judgment, I think on January 12th or 13th by the state government, is only there for government institutions. Even when such access is given, law books are required to be maintained when people actually sit down on a computer terminal to record who is accessing the internet through that computer terminal. That's the first thing that we see. The second is postpaid versus prepaid, right? The vast majority of people who access internet in India do it through prepaid mechanisms, because it's much easier on the pocket and they have a higher degree of control over their monthly expenditure on mobile and internet costs. Well, most of the connections which are even then permitted for mobile usage, not only for the internet but also for telecommunication services like voice calling, have been done for postpaid. Three, only 2G speeds are permitted. There's a vast difference in how speeds actually impact what kind of content can be consumed and distributed, and there's enough study around that. That the very nature of the internet is dependent on the nature of the speed by which you can access content over it. You won't be able to do multiplayer gaming with 2G speeds. Maybe. I think so. Maybe. Sometime. Mario? Maybe. Or Wolf? The fourth is VPN blocking. They start blocking VPNs in subsequent orders as well. And there's a lack of legality around the use of VPN, but they should be ordinarily permissible. Now, there is no clear direction or statement within the unified access licenses which permit large telecom companies to permit internet access, to provide internet access to end users, to prohibit VPNs. So there's no clear express prohibition on the use of VPNs on end users. maybe towards ISPs and telecoms of not to use mass or bulk encryption, but they don't apply to end users. And fifth and finally, what is the most concerning part of the post Anuradha Bhasin landscape is the process of whitelisting. That people can access 301 websites on 2G speeds sometimes, and these websites by themselves, as Prateek and Rohini who are in the room have analyzed, may not also work. So out of this 301, because they are quite often integrated elements within websites, these websites break, they're slow, and also sometimes they resolve to subdomains where the full functionality is available. So even that is not available. But much more worryingly, if you look at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 together, it's both an invasion of a person's privacy as well as their free expression in how they would ordinarily use the internet, how they would go and publish information and seek it. And it's that facility of choice, how we feel a very intimate connection when we are online. Why do minutes, then hours, and sometimes days just seem to dissolve online? And they do. It's because we have that facility to actually explore and travel through the internet. And I think this puts a huge boundary to that. And what it does in effect is it damages the public character at the core of the internet, which is something which became very, very visible through the net neutrality campaign, in which the essential argument was a facility of choice to the end user, that you should be able to go where you want to go, when you want to go, and what you want to access without entry barriers being put. So we have come back to a position where there is a selective permissiveness in what can be constituted as essential and non-essential. And this is essentially, at the end, a very arbitrary determination. One does not know how does one service provider, which may provide a functionality for people to have internet-enabled chats, is better than the other. This form of discrimination which is visited will become...
Sorry, go ahead.
Will become much more evident if one goes through the list of websites, all the 301 websites, and contrasts them against any other competing service, especially smaller services. Because the 301 websites will largely be of services which are predominantly used by a large number of people, but there are much more, many other services which are used for the specific functionality by other people as well. So, in a lot of ways, it's a discriminatory issue. And it also undermines the fundamental right to freedom of speech and expression, because the rule is freedom of speech and expression, and the exception is to place a restriction on it. A further question arises, why, what happens to the provision under the Information Technology Act with respect to selective blocking of websites? Can the state now pass an order to shut down the internet and permit 300 to 400 websites? And this is actually happening now in Kashmir. And given how internet shutdowns have spread all over India, this should concern all of us. So, what are directions both for research and advocacy have been touched upon by me in other talks, and I'll just come to them. What is the state of the research? And it's been done firstly with regard to the number of internet shutdowns. This has been done by three trackers, the most prominent of them built by the Software Freedom Law Center. It's called internetshutdowns.in. The second one is a global tracker by AccessNow. And the third one is a technical tracker by Facebook, in which figures are put out by Facebook when Facebook is not accessible in a specific region. Hallelujah, may that be the all of India. Okay, so the methodology in all three of them is not documented to a very high level of specificity. So if you ever take these figures and you try to canvass them in any kind of advocacy before the government or before court also, it may lead to falsification of results because they are primarily driven off an incomplete data set of the English press, where figures both by internet shutdowns brought in and accesses now figure itself of India not matching. It seems they are relying on certain keywords, not only in the English press, but further keywords in Google alerts to then pull data manually and populate the fields to come to a count of the total number of internet shutdowns. So when people say India has the highest number of internet shutdowns all over the world, I would say that is a correct statement, but still an understatement. They're in fact underreporting the number of shutdowns. The third is that there's friction and bias, which also comes out because you rely on crowdsourcing quite often, right? And in crowdsourcing, what happens is you sometimes don't have the technical facility of verification. Crowdsourcing also comes with a lot of other data side inadequacies. A lot of them are, illustrated by the Telecom Regulatory Authority in a consultation paper on the enforcement of network neutrality, which has just been released about 4 weeks back. Finally, RTIs, which have been filed at least prior to the Anuradha Bhasin judgment, have revealed answers only by two Indian states, that is by Rajasthan and Bihar. But post Anuradha Bhasin, there is an opportunity for two things. One, every time an internet shutdown order is made, a state government has to publish it on the state website. And secondly, there needs to be a central repository which is created by the government itself for these shutdown orders. I make these proposals because once the government itself creates a repository of internet shutdown orders, it's an admission, and at least we can go beyond the threshold issue of opacity and secrecy to much more substantive evaluations where we can focus our energies in court challenges. The second body of work and research which is concentrated and clustered here are economic losses. These have been done in three reports. The first by Darren West at Brookings in 2016. The second by the Indian Council for Research in International Economic Relations in 2018 by Mansi Kedi and Dr. Rajat Kathuria. And by the Global Network Initiative in 2018, which was a commission study. In all three, there is a mismatch in the methodologies which they have published. So there's a lack of standardization. The second is that they are ad hoc. They are not being housed institutionally. So you don't have regular release cycles in which there can be a dynamic reporting that how much economic loss is being impacted through internet shutdowns. This can be a very powerful tool in public advocacy. If the internet is shut down, for instance, in Delhi for 4 hours, a running counter which starts counting economic costs based on a methodology which is agreed by economists themselves. It is something which can put our policymakers and our public officials to deep shame and help them account for what happens to digital India. And it is something which should also have other stakeholders support such kind of outcomes, which would include people who would not be seen as traditional allies in this field. Who would they be? Airtel, Vodafone, and Reliance. It would also be people who come and build large technology platforms, but even smaller ones, since there would be a tremendous hurt and damage caused by them. So this is another direction where I think research, first by building a methodology and then being institutionally housed over a long term of 4 to 5 years, can be something that can really help advocacy outcomes in future. The third is the social engineering, because narratives are built not on the basis of figures, facts, but also what is the actual damage caused to people when an internet shutdown is affected. One of the most interesting interactions I've had around the internet shutdown was at the sideline of a panel discussion organized by NDTV for its show We the People, where the anchor was asking a person who came from an area where internet shutdown was impacted that how did it affect them. The person actually stated that my family could not get in touch with me. They panicked, they were in state of anxiety, and they thought that I may have been caught up in the unrest which was happening. So quite often this also echoes which have been early findings from how technology is used primarily by people who are situated in an area where there is a law and order disturbance. And this was a study which was done by the LSE with respect to the London riots, where BlackBerries were first used, right? And it was argued that rioters and looters were using and coordinating over BlackBerry messages. So it was both a problem in terms of technology, but also hint, hint, end-to-end encryption, right? But LSE actually did also social media analysis in which they found out that technology and social media was primarily being used for people to spread messages of calm, to alert law enforcement, and to call for medical help. I think ultimately it boils down to how do we view the neighbor? Do we view the neighbor as a person who will be a criminal, or will be a person who will be a partner and a colleague with us in advancing our constitutional goals? And here some studies have been done to demonstrate what is the social injury across very interesting vectors. The first is one done by 101 reporters at CIS. I think it draws very rich narratives in terms of what is the ground level impact of internet shutdowns on people. And it also reflects some of the litigations which have been filed in the past. For instance, the litigation which was filed in the Rajasthan High Court at Jodhpur was filed by a shopkeeper, Dharmendra Rajpurohit. The litigation which was filed in Gujarat prior to the internet shutdown rules was filed by a law student, Gaurav Suresh Bhai Vyas. So it came from a very diverse set of people, and now Anuradha Vasi. The second is by the Bachao Project. Again, you can chat with Rohini much more about this, published in 2018. It looks at it much more from a feminist perspective, because people who do ordinarily lack power in society sometimes use digital tools, especially the smartphone, to overcome those power imbalances. And once they are left without the in the Northeast much, much more severely than an upper caste man in Bangalore or India, they would not be able, for instance, to even conduct their daily activities or their household duties, which would be coordinated quite easily over a smartphone, right? Finally, the study which has come out much more recently, and I think is fairly influential, is by Jan Rajzer. He's at the Stanford Center for Internet Studies. And I think his study is peer-reviewed, but the issue that he indicates is that shutdowns are actually counterproductive. He says, firstly, the internet allows and permits a democratic vent, just like a pressure cooker, going back to why the Indian National Congress was created, for being a pressure cooker, right? Letting off the steam every now and then. So it's a bad analogy, but even then, the internet allows people to basically curse public officials rather than destroy public property. Okay, in a very rude, in very crude terms. The second thing is that the internet also brings and visits a level of accountability to official and policing responses. And we've seen it in the recent protests, how the internet is allowing, firstly, people to organize, and organize in a way in which there is planning. Once you organize in a planned way, rather than executing some nefarious plots to overthrow the government, you would actually organize to make yourselves feel comfortable, carry water and food, which you would make people less irritable, I would presume, and make sure that... Okay, what happened here? I'll do this.
Yeah.
Okay. Huh. It would make people organize in a much better way and not resort to violence, right? It just would seem
a much more rational way of how people would conduct themselves. But I don't know if reason and rationals are how people conduct themselves these days. But here's the thing. All of these studies need to be supported more. And I say that because they're limited in their geographical scope. We don't have a pan-India study for either one of these hypotheses. Even for ground reporting, I think national level work is required. And we need to also start getting all these studies done in a way that they can be peer-reviewed, referenced, because India, unfortunately, may have the highest number of internet shutdowns, but its researchers and its social science community can possibly contribute something better through it by being the first victims of this. This would obviously also include some amount of studies on computing and networking, as well as legal analysis. I don't consider legal analysis to be very, very, to be something which won't happen by itself, given that lawyers will write about it because they like to write and it will get covered. In computing and networking is where I do want to touch upon a little bit and urge researchers to look at an idea where rather than selective filtering, where you can divide certain parts of the internet through technologies such of network management and deep packet inspection, you would like to in fact unify and bond the core of the internet by itself, making it tougher for a permissiveness of certain category of websites by itself without shutting down the internet. Of course, it poses a much larger question then that what is better, a complete internet shutdown for a large place or a selective filtering and permissiveness of 301 websites. So it is something for people to gauge also in terms of advocacy outcomes. But I would pose that the long-term risks are not per se internet shutdowns, but are in fact in terms of weakening network protocols in which selective whitelists of 50,000 to 2 lakh websites are permitted for people in countries, thereby establishing a walled garden. Now, what can be done on advocacy? And these are some ideas which come through our work at Internet Freedom Foundation. And this may help you also understand what kind of work we hope to do here. How would we like to support people who are doing research along these areas? It would also possibly help you understand what areas and how do we break down issues when we look at them. So the first is public-facing work, which is towards making narrative control. The first element of this is broadening public participation. We cannot talk to people who already know about this issue. We in fact want this issue to become broad-based for more people to know about it and from different interest angles. They may be coming from a space in which they may be much more receptive to a message of it being an injury to our fundamental right to freedom of speech and expression. Or they may be coming to this space much more from an interest of how it's impacting the Indian economy. Or they may even come to this space with a sense that it is damaging India's global reputation and the larger ambitions of a digital India. We have to be flexible because that allows us, in fact, to have multiple constituencies who then get aligned and then start appreciating the very policy reforms and the research which is necessary. It will involve storytelling, cultural and media creation. It can't be done only on the basis of research. So rhetoric and appeals to emotion need to be created, but they need to be created on the basis of clear facts, methodology and research which should come first. And after that, we can actually do it. It can also coexist at the same point in time. One does not take away from the other, is what's my understanding. However, rhetoric, which is isolated and is not supported by research, is something which will not lead to long-term policy change. Finally, international and local press outreach. I think this does have an impact on how government thinks about this issue. It has an impact on how our institutions respond.
which would include the Supreme Court and have a realization that the press and the media play a very valuable role in narrative control. The second is what I was talking about a little time earlier. It's in terms of partnerships, in terms of widening the number of people who can actually work on these issues. And here, I would just like to mention how we can involve other arms of government as well. Given the economic costs which are at injuries which result from internet shutdowns, we have written regularly to the Ministry of Finance for including internet shutdowns as a core metric in the National Economic Survey, where it should start at least acknowledging that a huge amount of economic injury is caused, given that a large part of the GDP today is actually supported directly or indirectly by the internet economy. Secondly, the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India also should study this in its role, right? It's bringing up consultation papers on data ownership and privacy, which don't seem to be its core mandate. Why would it not study internet shutdowns by itself? Or whitelisting of websites, right? This is all which can be housed within government institutions by itself, because the government is not a monolith. The government, even today, is institutions which talk to each other in different ways and have different mandates and institutional cultures which have been set over a long period of time. So as much as we research and advocate, we should try all arms of government rather than just look towards the courts or look towards parliament. Okay? And we should also, I think, engage much more deeply with startups, with entrepreneurs who are also facing economic losses, and also realize that this is something which is unsustainable. Finally, in terms of institutional nudges and what can be done, I think what needs to be done is that, following up from the judgment, we need to request for compliance for the review of the internet suspension rules. The Internet Freedom Foundation will send such a demand to the Department of Telecom for compliance with the judgment in the next few days. Parliament needs to consider an internet access law in which the right to internet access is declared as a human right. It can also lead to tangential strategic victories for reforms legislatively on internet blocking as well as on internet shutdowns. And finally, we should look towards incremental challenges built through various high courts rather than go to the Supreme Court, given that there may be a very high degree of risk and we may be gambling with all the chips on the table rather than incrementally looking towards nudging the law in a positive direction. In fact, there is a petition which has been filed in the Supreme Court to challenge not the exercise of the power, but the very existence of the power itself, by a lawyer called Ehsan Hashmi. This petition may be listed tomorrow in the Supreme Court or may come up subsequently for hearing. And to us, it is not the best litigation strategy, but we do hope that nothing damaging comes through it. Given that there are existing challenges already, principally first in the Guwahati High Court, which do constitutionally challenge the telecom suspension rules. What Ehsan Hashmi seems to have done is that he's not only challenged the rules, which is the procedure, but also Section 5(2), which is the principal power by itself. So if you are not incrementally going, and if somebody has read Eshoff's fable, how the camel gets over the entire caravan itself, because the camel first puts one leg in into the tent, then another tent into the tent, and then kicks out the person who's inside. Okay, so that's how you should go about these things, rather than getting cooked and being tasty camel meat. Okay, so this is how we can possibly use all the research which is being done, which can be further improved in advocacy mode. Now, these all set piece strategies, their limits of forcibility and externalities are there. Something horrible may happen. There may be another public narrative which may be set, and this may become really, really a toxic area to work in, but I think these are best chances for reform. Now, finally, I would just like to come to, this is what is, now, it seems to be a really bad space we are in, but it's been much worse. If you look at the Indian Telegraph Act, it is a colonial enactment. If you look at the Indian Wireless Telegraphs Act, which is a separate enactment, every person who had a radio receiver, which also technically has the facility of transmitting radio signals, needed to get this license. And it's not that far back. And the Indian Wireless Telegraphs Act still stands till date. It's just that it has exemption notifications, which are today permitting us to have smartphones without getting this license with the law. Okay? And the internet has done a lot of fantastic things. For instance, it allows us to broadcast over a very, very large area to multiple recipients without boundaries without territorial boundaries and without economic costs which were traditionally associated with broadcast. So today, in a lot of ways, we ourselves are broadcasters. And this was not permitted by the Indian government for about 30 years back. And it's all happened over a period of time. And that's why policy setting and looking towards the future in the larger course of time as decades becomes really important. Now, finally,
just like to end with this,
I think it's quite clear that when you shut down the internet, you shut down India. And I think having even that kind of narrative is really beneficial. And the government seems to get it, even though it may not acknowledge it. And this is what I leave you by saying, that to shut down the internet is today in a lot of ways to shut down India, because the tri-quarterly indicators also show it that for the first two times, at least over the last three quarters, there are more internet connections per person in India than actual people in India itself. So with that, let's close it here. I think I've far exceeded the time I had to take, and people are yawning at the time. Okay? So let's open this up to any kind of questions, comments, and if there are any, please go ahead.
The previous slide, the one with the license. It's interesting that you spoke about device licenses for wireless equipment. So when the conversation around data localization starts, they do it for a particular reason, is put for a particular reason. But it does also feel like trying to curb the extent that we get to communicate.
Yeah, so for everyone, data localization is an argument to compulsorily store data within the territorial boundary of India when that data is generated in India and it comes out of a series of conversations which have been premised on an idea of sovereignty and securitization and data as a strategic resource. So these are three interest vectors which are quite often articulated, in which India is today data rich and it should in fact hoard this resource for its strategic purposes. So it firstly presumes that the state is the sovereign, which goes against any notion of constitutionality, because if you read the constitution assembly debates or even the preamble, it says we the people hereby so it, and to secure, etc., etc. So it basically means that we are the sovereign and the government is the custodian of that sovereign power. It's also articulated in the context of telecommunications very clearly in the 1995 judgment of Cricket Association of Bengal versus Secretary Information and Broadcasting, where the government is reasoned by the Supreme Court to be a custodian of spectrum, which has to act fairly rather than being the owner and the sovereign of it. The second underlying element which is there in data localization is of securitization, that data, if it's stored within India, will be much more secure. I'm not going to labor on this much, except say 14 feet high walls. Okay. And the third is data is a strategic resource. We are data rich. Data is rich because it's a data exchange by itself. The minute data stops flowing, the value for that stops. And quite often data is being generated. It's because there are products and services which are being utilized, which are made available to people in India for, with providers for providing these facilities from abroad. So a lot of these arguments have actually been analyzed by Professor Anupam Chandar, who has articulated quite clearly that none of these reasons for data localization are actually met by actually localizing data. So it's an irrational argument which is built of a certain degree of parochialism. I would at the same time say that data localization needs to be a policy which can be followed through support and through giving a stimulus in a much more rational manner to local industry and back-end cloud providers, rather than through regulatory intervention and such hard measures. Also, data localization is a policy which can be followed for specific classes of data which are incredibly sensitive, like health and financial data, by sectoral regulators. This has been acknowledged by Professor Graham Greenleaf from the University of Queensland in Australia, who studies privacy and data protection laws across the larger Commonwealth. Okay? But having a blanket data localization policy again has those same elements which sometimes are quite visible with internet shutdowns. It is a tendency to control of the state being fearful, as it should be, because right-thinking people will put it to account.
So while it would be nice to not have internet shutdowns at all, but there is an argument between blanket ban and surgical bans, right? Like selective internet access, will it not make the legal fight more complicated? And also, number two, will it not give more power to the government to feed the data that it wants to people? Because in the end, the officials are deciding what to
do. Yeah, you're correct in both things. So, proportionality is the principal argument, if you go back to it, okay, which the court acknowledges here. So the core argument against internet shutdowns is that you can't distinguish between legal forms of speech and illegal forms of speech, and hence you're not making an individual assessment and shutting down the medium itself. Thereby, it is disproportionate to any reasonable restriction. So reasonable restrictions are specific grounds, right? Like defamation, like public order. And if you shut down the internet itself, the large category of speech is not defamation and is not inciting offenses or disturbing public order, right? So this core argument by itself goes away, because the government says we are only permitting 300 websites and not social media where all of this kind of other stuff is happening. We saw a similar variation of this argument in the Gaurav Suresh Bhai case, which is called Gaurav Suresh Bhai Vyas versus State of Gujarat, in which the High Court of Gujarat actually reasoned that because the state is providing people with the facility of wired internet access, when it shuts down mobile internet access, the exercise of the internet shutdown power is reasonable. So if the state does permit whitelisting, just going by this judgment itself, it seems that it's doing a good job. And it would also seem to be a very pragmatic compromise, right? But it's not. The second question by you was?
Will it not, like, feeding in selective data?
Yeah, so it will increase the state power to drive narrative control and control how people choose to correspond with each other. because this kind of filtering, if we go back, also involves a large measure in which VPNs and privacy controls are taken away. And in fact, if you notice in one foreign country itself, I'm forgetting the name of that country, but there's a requirement to in fact install a security certificate within your browser to access the internet. Kazakhstan. And that permits the government to know every website that you visited. So you will, and when you don't have privacy, what happens is, and there's been research post Snowden revelations by itself on Americans, in which they stop searching for certain things online. And if this is happening in America with their rule of law framework and their First Amendment, we can well imagine what it would happen in spaces beyond Bangalore and Delhi, where our rule of law framework quite often works to the wishes of a local tough guy or a politician. So yeah, it will do that. So privacy goes, and the second is narrative control becomes even stronger for several reasons. One is that the government principally only allows government broadcast mechanisms, right? So the large number of websites which are available would be government websites. And secondly, the providers, private providers who would be permitted to be on that whitelist would be those which would also be compliant with what would be the narrative which is being desired by the government in terms of its political objectives, right? And we've already seen some conversation around how Jio chat is permitted, but other chat clients are not permitted internet based. So definitely it is a problem, and we'll have to think about it.
Can I just add to that? So when we analyze these now 328 websites that have been tested, so at 301 is where we stopped sort of categorizing them. At that time, we found that about 58 of these websites were actually just usable, where you could do the main purpose, right? Most of them were very light websites that were only text information. The problem with the whole whitelisting approach is it's not how the internet is designed. Every website uses a lot of different domains to pull content, images from somewhere, CDN from somewhere. We didn't even consider the impact on things like Google Analytics, a lot of marketing, because we looked at it from a user's perspective. So we're like, okay, let's put the website owner out of it, even though it is a genuine problem for them. Right? We looked at it purely from a user's perspective. So of the 301 URLs we found, it was actually quite funny. We had to exclude about 30 of them just on the basis of there were no URLs, there were duplicates, there was typos in there, right? What we were left with was about 270. We found 126 were either usable or partially usable, 144 was just not usable at all.
What were the typos?
That is the wrong website. So there is
Skoda Auto.
So it was Oppo-in. Right? Nobody knows what that is. The Skoda one is a good example. Money control is there three times. Someone really likes money control. There was all the banking websites. It was very funny because I don't know who came up with this list. Because all of them, you can't really get to the personal banking.
Nobody knows who came up with that list.
That's the beauty, right? No one knows who came up with that list.
Principal secretary came up.
There were repetitions on consecutive roles, right?
Yeah.
So, who looked at this list? Who reviewed this list? That judgment aside.
Yeah.
So when we looked at all the banking websites, there were 14 of them that were categorized as banking. 12 of them, you couldn't get to the login page. Because the login page was on.
It'll become better. These are teething problems.
Maybe. Although that's what worries me, right?
That's what worries me.
The incremental approach. So it started with 143, became 301, now 328. And then the latest order, 31st Jan order, they removed the categories. So now it's just a list of.
I think it goes back to what I was saying earlier, right? My fear is not the 301 or 328. It is even 5 to 10 lakh websites,
yes.
Which are permitted in India, and if you go beyond that, you basically hit a wall.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's like that Jim Carrey movie where he's staying in a sitcom kind of world, right? And he discovers this is a war. Sure. Yeah, and you can't go beyond it. You need to turn back.
And it's like you have the French Canadian version of Yahoo. Who uses that? In India. Right?
French Canadian.
Google.co.in was on there. Google.ca was on there.
Okay.
I was also going to ask a similar thing, like what do we do about third party cookies and everything
none of that would work.
Yeah.
So anything from back or from here? Yeah.
What preemptive action can we take? Like right now, everything that we're doing is kind of reactive to the internet shutdowns that happen. But like, for example, there are no rules like currently on the exact process of using third-person, like the VPNs and such, or even the Bridgeify and stuff, like the peer-to-peer stuff. So are there ways that we can act on this to like solidify rules before things happen?
I think with regard to circumvention technologies by itself, two challenges will be faced. The first is the legal challenge by itself, in which to operate a network beyond a certain network area, which is exempted at present, and to transmit at certain frequencies, you will run into problems with the Indian wireless telegraphs. So, that is also an illustrative problem in number two, which is that a lot of these solutions will not be scalable. And you notice that much more towards in terms of implementation frameworks, where there'll be device fragmentation. So you won't be able to implement the same solution. But I think these are areas we need to invest in, we need to discover more, irrespective of where the law is today. Because I think ultimately people do need to come up with solutions irrespective of what 60-year-old law has placed in terms of boundaries. People eventually should also control the ability to communicate with their neighbors rather than just being at the mercy of an internet service provider. But availability of the wider public internet will require substantial legal and regulatory reform, as well as the core aspects of research which will be necessary. Let's look at this as a battle which needs to be fought over a period of time. It won't result in immediate and quick victories, and it will possibly take, I won't lie to you, it will take years, if not a decade, close to a decade, for this reform to take place. But if we don't work, it won't. Okay, and even when it does, it will be very radical when it does. Okay, so I do think that there are opportunities, but we need to double down and do more work on this.
Do you think that, as you considering Anuradha Bhasin's case, that the Supreme Court takes a convenient stance of answering procedural questions and not the substantive ones, except for the doctrine of proportionality, of course? Like, do you think there's a recent trend you just noticed in the judgments where the procedural questions are answered in order to circumvent the difficult questions, like, say, right to freedom of speech and expression in Anuradha Bhasin?
So, this is also what something happened here in Anuradha Bhasin. We didn't actually go to the court with any kind of substantive answer.
Okay.
Because we feared that we would get a negative answer. So the court, in fact, does not reason whether the right to the internet can be an independent right under Article 20, because we don't argue it. We said, please don't actually rule on it. We don't even challenge the existence of the bar. We said, we deal with it later. And it's also done because, remember who's the other side there and what is the argument they are making. Everything is pegged with argument which is a court securitization argument. Every second sentence is Burhan, Pani and Afzal in that courtroom. Okay, so the chances of you losing are way higher. The second thing is this a recent trend? Civil rights advocates have never won a clear case on
against the national security argument, except the narco analysis engine, according to me. So we, even when we won on Tata, we lost. Okay, the court just said amend the act in these ways, and we have not truly ever won on a national security argument ever. Even though the constitutional framework seems to be fairly opposed to rights being denuded just because a national security argument is being made. But the court's trend with regard to national security has become much more prominent. It's because the government has argued it much more. And institutionally, it's not as strong as it used to be earlier. So we'll get a clearer sense. Anuradha Bhasin judgment is troubling because it's wishy-washy. It doesn't actually adjudicate on the legality of the sample 10 orders. So if they did and they applied the principles that they articulated to those 10 orders and struck them down, it would have given necessary confidence to petitioners and parties who are assessing its legality in future challenges before state high courts as well. So it doesn't even take those 10 template orders, because they just said one line, the internet is suspended, so and so, here and here, to maintain peace, calm, etc. And if you look at the recent orders, much more recent orders which have been passed post January 10th, they contain elaborate reasons in which it's based on intelligence inputs and files carefully reviewed by several police and law enforcement departments. So it seems to actually record reasons to such a great length, but they're repeating those reasons again and again, okay, in all the orders, and the template is sticking. So we'll be able to build a challenge later if they are watching. Okay. But here's the thing, the state will always act like this because it has power. So I don't think so it will do anything. But yeah, there will be future challenges, and I hope this answers your question to some level of satisfaction. Yeah, anyone else here? Anything else you would like to ask me about internet shutdowns, free expression, online, IFAB's work? Yeah, please.
We are talking about the standardization of how we are measuring the economic loss.
Yeah.
So, I mean, have you guys like did some work in the direction?
We don't do research.
Okay.
We do advocacy. So, when we come and we talk to researchers and research institutions, we make requests and asks, and we say we can possibly use this in advocacy modes. It can be beneficial and it can result in kind of policy changes. So, we only... Our speciality is advocacy, it's not research per se.
So, I have a question. I wanted to know what IFAB is doing in terms of right to privacy, because the new data protection bill is still in the joint committee, but it's going to maybe pass, may not be passed, but with changes or not. So, what is IFAB doing in that category? I'd like to know.
Yeah, so we've been running a campaign called Seva Privacy. It has a model privacy code. It's filed as a private member's bill in the present session of parliament, where Dr. Ravi Kumar, who is a member of parliament in the Lok Sabha from the DMK, that private member's bill will provide a blueprint when the government's data protection law is introduced to contrast what can be a good civil society version versus what can be a government version. And the government version's lacuna can be then highlighted against that. So there can be an active debate in parliament. The other thing which we are doing is that we are encouraging more public engagement. We are firstly using our social media outreach to inform people how to engage in this process. In fact, only yesterday there was a meetup done at the Gojek tech offices here in Bangalore, where about 30 to 35 people turned up, and we talked about just how they could email the chairperson of the Joint Parliamentary Committee, Mrs. Meenakshi Lekhi, which is also her email address, Mrs. Meenakshi Lekhi. So we put out a consultation guide now, much more substantively, in which we tell what is the past history of the present government draft, breaks it down in one page,
then on the next page there are 10 top issues, and then each so we're doing all of these kind of things. As we go forward, we'll be doing things privately and publicly. The private advocacy will include one-to-one meetings with members of parliament, briefing them on various aspects of the bill. Because to us, the joint parliamentary committee is not the end of the process. The joint parliamentary committee comes up with a report and a modified bill, which is then again put forward to the parliament itself, after which both houses will deliberate on the data protection bill and it will pass. Yesterday at Gojek, I also touched upon the history of the RTI. And it's in this book, which is called the RTI story. And the greatest lesson from that book, just coming back to another answer I just gave, is that the nature of all of these enactments is that there are large interest groups who are impacted and hold power when they have to either part with the information or they can't acquire an individual's information. And these interests keep on subsisting. And legal intervention is a safeguard which corrects this imbalance. But just because it corrects this imbalance, firstly, it won't correct it perfectly. The RTI Act was first passed in the states, then passed as a central enactment, which was bad. And then we got the RTI Act in its present form, which has been successively diluted both in its operation as well as its rules by various governments, right? So the nature of this is you won't get the best thing in the first shot, okay? But something is better than nothing. Secondly, something is better than nothing, but we can build on to this something towards something better as well. And even when we get something better, it can always go away, right? So, it seems exhausting, right? But this is the nature of this work.
You said that the panel that reviews the rules or the reasons
the review committee.
The review committee, yeah. So, is the review committee impervious?
Sounds very elitist, right?
The review committee. So, it sounds way too academic to the work that they're actually doing. Is it impervious to the RTI?
Nothing is impervious to the RTI. It's a public authority which needs to proactively disclose the reasons for any of the decisions that it takes.
Right.
However, the RTI Act by itself relies on an enforcement framework which is not very strong. In fact, lawyers, when they first initially wanted to file RTIs for the internet shutdown orders in Jammu and Kashmir, guess what's the first problem they ran into? The post offices were not working.
And the data protection bill does not make it any easy for the RTI infrastructure either.
The data protection bill in the present version actually is an improvement from the Sri Krishna version.
Right.
The Sri Krishna version contemplated specific changes to the language of section 81J of the RTI Act, in which the ground for restricting disclosure in public interest, which had privacy, was diluted. And privacy was put on almost an equal footing with it.
Right.
This enraged RTI, the RTI community, quite justifiably, right? And our approach towards all of this, under our model bill, which is in Parliament as well, through a private member's bill, which I just referred, has been, you should have a definition in the schedule to exempt the application of the data protection bill to specific acts, that it can't touch it. Those acts will determine privacy by itself. And the RTI Act under 81J already has precedent on when certain details are not made available in public interest because it undermines privacy. So let that stand and let the data protection law operate in a complete silo without touching upon the RTI Act. That should be the approach, right? So this is recognized to a certain degree in the present data protection bill because it does not seek to amend the RTI Act anymore. Okay?
Not directly.
Actually. Not directly. But it still has a clause which says that the data protection bill will override any other law which conflicts with it.
Yeah.
So if the conflict exists between the RTI Act and the data protection bill,
then
the data protection bill will override it.
the only way to get out of this is again to have a schedule in which you say that irrespective of anything in the data protection bill, it will not touch the RTI Act. We also propose another law which it should not touch. Which one is that? And that's a bit problematic, our suggestion here. But it's also not problematic. The Representation of People Act. Because electoral rules which are there, right? You do need privacy protection around that for preventing micro-targeting, etc. and profiling. But at the same point of time, there's a core democratic interest in preventing voter fraud by making sure that I can go and check who's voting in the locality. It emerges from a very democratic intent. Of course, it's not playing out like that today. But we say these two laws, as much as they may be facing their own peculiar problems, their paths towards reform are their own independent paths.
Right.
And the data protection law does not have business
in
getting into their business.
But this is what Srinivas was also saying, how it kind of messes around with...
The present draft, to its credit, does not do it
on its face,
but may do it in time. So this is one of the issues we've also touched upon in a 7-page brief and explanation we made on the data protection bill. And you can actually email Meenakshi Lekhi with your own views about it, because they have opened it up to public comments. It doesn't need to be something which is very, very legally articulated. If you see a lot of people who did participate and who do participate in public consultations come from their core areas of understanding, from things that they work on, or sometimes they just feel very passionate about something and they set that in. It helps people and it helps parliamentarians also appreciate it. Okay, so do engage.
Can you give us some perspective on some other countries, Zimbabwe, Egypt, other countries, the way they have kind of gone through the similar process of internet shutdown, the citizen kind of have I'm trying to understand the nature of shutdowns here in India, and does it differ from other countries, and how citizens have overcome some part of it, if you know.
Yeah, Egypt, they overthrew Mubarak after
Egypt.
I think internet shutdowns have been done also frequently in Iran. I've not looked at how people have overcome them there, but I think they do have a large technical community, and it's been fairly resilient over a period of time, even using cable television systems and creating local wide area networks, sometimes to watch the latest Netflix shows. You can keep it on a hard drive, like a small educational campus. But there are ways people have gotten around it. But here's the thing, because even today, the internet infrastructure does ultimately require people to connect to a landing cable, right? The undersea landing cable, which is controlled by the government. Or there's a pipe which goes somewhere. It can switch it off and switch it on. And it does license it, and it does control the entire chain around information. So technically, that is an issue. But what has been the popular response to shutting down the internet quite often has been to question the public official or the public authority around it. I think India is the only country which is a democratic country to a large extent with institutions which work, which is permitting this practice to spread in such a way.
It's permitted. Good news.
Everything is good news. All news is good news.
We're already crossed the 7:30 mark, 10 minutes ago. And Apari is here.
I'm here. I'm here till about 8:15, 8:30, outside or wherever, depending on comfort.
Could we have a please a huge round of applause for
Apari? Huge round of applause for the patient, guys. Thank you for Thursday. Remember the keychains.
Yes, keychains are here. If you do want to sign up for the CIS newsletter or something to get updated about events such as these, please drop your visiting card or your email address at the desk here.
There is some tea and samosas in the kitchen and cake. Okay. Please feel free to help yourself. And Abhay is also here for a few minutes in case you want to discuss something.
Okay, a few minutes.
Then we need to
stop work.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.